Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Elhamdülillahi Rabbil alemin. Vessalatu vesselamu ala seyyidil mursalin. Now when you refer back to our last lesson, I think it was Sunday, so many of us may have forgotten maybe the course subject matter which we were studying, but hopefully most of us remember. So inshallah, if we try and keep that in our minds, what we studied before, what we're studying going forward, and we keep it in our minds and we try and engage and bring it into our lives, one of the best ways to ever never forget something is to make it a part of your life. If a person every time he's going up the stairs he's saying takbir, and when he's coming down he's saying tasbih, then he'll never forget that the sunnah of going up the stairs or going up a hill is to say takbir, and when you're coming down to do tasbih. So all of these things, when they become ingrained within our lives, then it's very difficult to ever forget them. The stories that we mention, I mean, right at the beginning in the first lesson we covered the main point, what the point of this whole book is, which is to actually bring some kind of self-accounting into our lives. So doing that now has many, many different aspects, which is what we're going through. So how to bring self-accounting into our lives has different aspects. So every time we hear a story from of somebody from the Salaf who does something which helps him become a better person, and the Prophet ﷺ endorses that, and the Sahaba endorse that, and the Salaf always promote this kind of thinking and activity, then these are all attributes and qualities which we should all try and consider in some way implementing into our lives, inshallah. So it's important that we keep these in mind, that what is it that we take away from everything that we hear. The first narration is from Talha radiallahu anhu, and he mentions that in Talha rajulun dhata yawmin fanaza'a thiyaba wa tamarraga fi ramdha, that one day a person, he went and he removed some of his clothing, and then he began to tamarrag, he began to roll around in the ramdha, in the hot dust of Arabia at that time. So it was very, very hot, and he was rolling around without, and obviously if you have clothes on then it doesn't affect you as much, but he took some of his clothes off so his body can get exposed directly to the heat. And while doing this, يَقُولُ لِنَفْسِهِ ذُوكِ نَارُ جَهَنَّمَ أَشَدُّ حَرًّا, and then he said to himself that taste this, because the fire of Jahannam is more severe. جِفَةٌ بِاللَّيْلِ وَبِطَانَةٌ بِالنَّهَارِ, and then he describes himself, he says that in the daytime you're just a corpse, you don't do much, you don't do what you're meant to be doing. And this is his way of lamenting himself, that you yourself, you've done this kind of action. Bitala, somebody who does nothing. He's somebody who's, sometimes nowadays it's used in modern Arabic, a batala is somebody who's unemployed, doesn't do anything, just sits on the couch, watches TV all day and takes benefits from the government. This is how they're described. Qal, and then the Talha radiallahu anhu, who's watching the incident and narrating the incident, he mentions that بَيْنَ كَذَلِكَ بَيْنَ هُوَ كَذَلِكَ, while he was in this condition, so he's rolling around in the hot dust and lamenting himself, saying that you've done this, you need to become a better person, you're doing all these wrong things. So while he was doing this, أَبْصَرَ النَّبِيَّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, the person who was rolling around, he saw the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم في ذِلِ شَجَرًا, he was taking shade under a tree. And فقال, and then he mentioned that غلبتني نفسي, when he realized the Prophet ﷺ was in the vicinity, he described the situation, he explained to the Prophet ﷺ what he's doing. He said غلبتني نفسي, this is the whole summary of why he's doing what he's doing. So he's lamenting himself, telling himself off, he said because غلبتني نفسي. Now this is not, the explicit details are not mentioned, but he said I was overcome by my desires, I done something which I wasn't meant to do, this is why I'm doing this. He was explaining to any person who's watching in case they're confused, which they're probably. Okay, so then قال له النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم mentions to him, ألم يكن لك بدا من الذي صنعت, he said could you not have avoided this, is it not possible you didn't do this, what you've done is very, very grave, it's amazing what you've done, it's just on another level, nobody else has done what you've done. He's referring to his lamenting on himself, telling himself off and rolling around in the dirt. He said as a result of what you've done, لقد فتحت لك أبواب السماء, that for you the doors of the heavens have opened, ولقد باه الله بك الملائكة, and Allah is now boasting about you to the angels. And this is how the result of what he done. So originally he just took, the main thing he done is he just took his sin seriously. He took the evil which he done seriously, and then he done as much as he could to then make his repentance to Allah, to make himself a better person. He scolded himself, telling him that the sin that you've done will get you in Jahannam essentially, unless you demand forgiveness. However, the heat which you're trying to take from the ground, rolling around in the hot desert of Arabia, this is something you can't bear. So how are you going to bear the stronger heat? This is similar to the first narration where the person put his finger in the fire. So Prophet ﷺ then said that, you know, this is the result he gets, that Allah, this is the love Allah has. He said, "Futihat laka as-sama," that all of the doors of the heavens have opened for you. This is how much love Allah had for this person doing this action. And then he said, as well as that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is boasting about you to the angels. This is how much love Allah has. This is how proud Allah is of this person. That what a great thing he's done. And this is just taking the sin seriously, making sure that it changes life. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, now remember, this is a big thing, that the doors of the heavens are open for you. This is a great thing. As we know, in Ramadan, the hadith mentions that the doors of the heavens are continuously open throughout the whole month. But however, because it happened specifically for this person, and the Prophet said that specifically for you, the doors of the heavens have been opened. The Prophet ﷺ then said li ashabi, to the Sahaba, tazawwadu min akhikum, that tazawwadu, take provisions, take benefit, take something from him. Look how special he is. The doors of heavens have been opened for him. Allah's boasting about him to the angels. So you also, now he's here, you also take benefit. And like we mentioned before, that you sometimes you can take dua from other people as well. You should sometimes tell other people to make dua for you. If somebody else has reached a height, if somebody's, you know, in i'tikaf, if somebody's in the path of Allah, if somebody's going to in the path of Allah somewhere, if somebody's going for Hajj or Umrah, or somebody's doing something amazing, then it's okay for a person to ask them to do dua for them as well. And sometimes it's recommended as well. So the Prophet ﷺ here, he recommends it. It's not a common thing, but sometimes the Prophet ﷺ would tell people to ask other people to make dua for them. It shouldn't become so common that at the end of every single text message you put, "Keep me in your du'as," because that loses the whole point of a du'a. It's almost like making a joke out of du'a. So you should be, you know, constrained to that extent. It shouldn't become that common. This hadith, obviously, if somebody quotes this hadith, says the Prophet ﷺ told the Sahaba to take benefit from the akhi. Look how special the time is. This one person, he done so. Look what he done, firstly. So first we do what the Sahaba done, which is rolling around and completely understanding our sin. And then a person, you know, he becomes on a level where he becomes worthy of the Sahaba asking him to do du'a for him. So then the Prophet ﷺ said, asking for dua. So فَجَعَلَ الرَّجُلُ يَقُولُ لَهُ يَا فُلَانُ أُدْعُ لَهُ. That a person said, you know, make dua for him. Then one person asked this. Then the قَالَ لَهُ رَسُولُ اللَّهُ. So the Prophet ﷺ, he said to him, that أُمَّهُمْ, that only one person has asked you, but you be general. You try and encompass everyone. Make dua for all, everybody here. So the person, he made dua, Allahumma ajri taqwa zadahum wajma' ala al-huda amrahum, and make the, so Allah, he says, make that the main provision is taqwa, that they always have taqwa in their lives, and also make them collected upon guidance, make whatever they do, make it be an action of guidance. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, while he's making this dua, he said, Allahumma saddidhu, the Prophet is making dua for him, and he says, make that the dua that he's making, make sure that he makes the correct dua. So he's making dua for everyone else, the Prophet ﷺ making dua for him. And then to the extent that the Prophet ﷺ said, be as general as you can. One, to encompass everyone, and also make du'as which are jami' and encompass all of their needs. To the extent, Allahumma waj'alil jannah ma'abahum, to the extent that he ended up saying, that dua led him to saying that make Jannah everybody's permanent abode. So this is the way that the dua is. So many things that we learn. One of the things that we learn is that du'as become accepted of people who take tawbah seriously, who take themselves to account, who look at their sins and say that I've done this wrong, I need to change this, I need to sort this out. This is so many lessons we take from this narration. And Allah loves this, that du'as get accepted of this person, and also that we should try and do du'a for each other. And, you know, also sometimes ask other people to do du'a for us as well. The next narration is from Hudhayfa bin Qatada radiallahu an, and he says that he was said to a person, كيف تصنع في شهوتك, that a person was asked that, how do you deal with your desires? فقال ما في الأرض نفس أبغض إلي منها فكيف أطيها شهوتها. He said that in the whole world there's nobody who is more, who I hate more than my own desires. There's nobody who I try and take to account more than my own desires. Sometimes when we hate somebody, we like to take them to account. Suddenly whenever we look at them or we hear about them, all of their faults come to our mind. If we don't like somebody, we'll never see good in them. So this is one thing which he had developed with his own desires, his own nafs. that he himself, he'd managed to bring himself on that level where he hated himself. Now that doesn't mean that we, you know, do evil things to ourselves, but we control ourselves, we bring ourselves under control. This is how he does it. So that way, when a person has this regard for himself, he doesn't see his own good achievements and display them everywhere and say, I spent the whole of Ramadan and I finished 15 Qurans, or I done this, or I'm always in the first surf. But he always managed to find ways to improve. And this way, when a person's improving, then the whole community will find ways to improve. If a person manages to assess himself and take ways to improve himself. So it says that, and to the extent the benefit here is that then it will become very difficult for him to give him the shahawat, the desires. So if there's something which he desires, then he will keep that away from his nafs, from himself. He won't give it unlimited access to whatever he wants. He will control it and make sure that he only has things which he needs, or which he should be having. And the next narration which is mentioned is Dakhla ibn al-Samak ala Dawud al-Tai. Dawud al-Tai came before a very, very amazing aesthetic and also a very, very pious person, very knowledgeable person as well. Hinamat, when he was passing away, وَهُوَ فِي بَيْتٍ عَلَى الْتُرَابِ He was in his house on the floor. And then he mentioned that سَجَنْتَ نَفْسَ the person passing away, Dawud Tai, he mentioned to himself, he was addressing himself, now obviously he's about to die. He said, سَجَنْتَ نَفْسَكَ قَبْلَ أَن تُفْجَنْ وَعَذَّبْتَ نَفْسَكَ قَبْلَ أَن تُعَذَّبْ فَالْيَوْمْ تَرَى مَنْ كُنْتَ لَهُ تَعْمَلْ. And this is very profound, and there's many things which he said throughout his life, but he said that you kept control of your nafs before your nafs was put into control of somebody else, before death. Death comes and we lose control of our own nafs. Our amal don't benefit us anymore. So he said, you done this before you died. وَعَذَّبْتَ نَفْسَكَ. And you also took yourself to account and you punished yourself for things that you done wrong yourself. Just like in this above narration. When a person done something wrong, he took himself to account. He punished himself. He said, this is wrong, let me punish myself. And this led to so many other benefits. So here, he says that in the world you would punish yourself. So now, فَالْيَوْمْ تَرَى مَنْ كُنْتَ لَهُ تَعْمَلْ. Now you have the opportunity to see that person or that being for whom you left all of these evils. So all of the actions that you've done in the world, today you get the opportunity to see that person for whom you've done it. And obviously that means Allah. So if a person, he lives his life properly, and all of us, we should try and develop this desire to meet Allah. I mean, we spend the whole, if we're praying five times a day we're talking to Him, we're telling Him things, we're having a conversation with Him. So our link with Him should be developed in every salah, especially in Ramadan. It should be developed even more because we have so much taraweeh and all of these things continuously. We should become so aware of Him that we should be able to feel His presence. We should be able to be aware of how to get our needs fulfilled from Allah, to the extent that we become desirous of actually meeting Him, and we become desiring of dying so that we can actually get this opportunity to meet Him. Obviously, we'll only desire that when we live a life like this. If a person takes himself to account, if a person realizes what he's done wrong, if a person has love for Allah, he does those actions which please Allah, and he lives his life in accordance with the wishes of Allah. So this is how he explains it, that because you control yourself in the life, now when you're dying, you'll be able to meet Allah. And obviously meeting Allah in a state, obviously Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that often He will not speak to those people who done evil things in the world. So Allah will not speak to them, not look at them. So these are things that, you know, which is a privilege to be able to speak to Allah and meet Allah. But obviously we'll only consider that a privilege if we have something, if we have a face to show Him when you meet Him. So this is obviously an incentive to keep control of our actions in the world. And the last narration, which is the last narration of the chapter as well, which is from Wahab ibn Munabba, who we mentioned before. أَنَّ رَجُلًا تَعَبَّدَ زَمَانًا ثُمَّ بَدَتْ لَهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ حَاجَةً فَصَامَ سَبْعِينَ سَبْتًا. A person, he had a need. And there was a person who was very, very pious. He used to worship for a very long time. And then suddenly, at one point, a need arose for him. So then he decided that to fulfill this need, he will fast for 70 weeks. And in those 70 weeks, every week he would only eat 11 dates. And then, after doing this amazing thing of fasting for 70 weeks, and then every week only eating 11 dates, trying to think of some of us who managed to eat 11 dates just in one iftari. Then he asked Allah for this hajj. He had a need that came up. And then he asked for this need, and then he fasted for 70 days. After fasting, he asked Allah for his hajj. فَلَمْ يُؤْتِهَا. However, Allah did not fulfill this need of his. فَرَجَعَ إِلَىٰ نَفْسِهِ. Then he came and spoke to himself, and he said to himself that فَقَالَ مَنَّكَ أُتِيتَ لَوْ كَانَ فِيكَ خَيْرًا. He goes that if you had good in you, this desire of yours, this man which you have, this desire that you want to achieve, if there was any good in you, you would have been given it. But because you're so evil, because you do so many wrong things, because you fail to do all these things properly, that's why you're not being given your thing. And when he said this, and now this is, remember, this book is about muhasabah, taking ourselves to account. The benefit of muhasabah was, فَنَزَلَ إِلَيْهِ إِنْدَ ذَلِكَ مَلَكْ فَقَالَ يَا ابْنَ آدَمْ سَاعَتُكَ هَذِهِ خَيْرٌ مِنْ إِبَادَتِكَ الَّتِي مَضَتْ وَقَدْ قَضَى اللَّهُ حَاجَتَكَ. Then when he said this, these words, that you are, because of the lack of good in you, he didn't blame Allah, he didn't take his anger on Allah. He blamed himself for his own actions. He took himself to account and he tried to figure out why is this not being accepted. So when he'd done that, then the angel came down. When that happened, and he said, O son of Adam, this moment of yours, this is better than the ibadah, the 70 weeks of fasting which you passed, and Allah has now fulfilled your need. So obviously, because of his muhasabah which he done, and because of the accounting which he done for himself, and taking himself to account, and realizing that he himself is not really worthy so much of the benefits of Allah, of Allah's accepting his dua, then when he realized that, then the angel came down and said that your need is fulfilled. So I make Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the ability to understand, act upon, and appreciate what has been said.